All right, let's bring in our panel now. Two former state lawmakers with us today, Democrat Marianne Sullivan, Republican Mike Murphy, and Abdul Hakim Shabazz, the editor and publisher of IndyPolitics.org. And Marianne, I'll start with you. You also served recently as IPS board president. How big an issue will teacher pay be this session, even though by all indications it's not an issue that's going to see actual legislative action in a non-budget year?
Yeah, I think it's going to be a big issue, and I think it's going to be a big issue, rightly so. However, I do agree that probably most significant action, the kind of action that's really going to make a difference for teachers long term and make a difference for our state, is probably going to occur in the future, which does not mean there's not a lot of smaller ways that the legislators can lay the groundwork for some really good work to help move more dollars to teacher pay at the local level.
Does it become, though, Mike, a political concern, a political liability at all for the governor in an election year?
Not really. He's saying the right things. I mean, for the governor, he has to get through this session making zero mistakes, because he's pretty popular right now, and why hurt your popularity by putting
His
up
polling
proposals?
Numbers have been very good.
They're very good. So he's going to get through this. The word has gone out. This is going to be a small ball session. Talk about teacher pay all you want. It's the school boards who raise teachers' pay, not the legislature.
You guys have both served in the legislature. How well does that work when the word gets down that they want it to be a small or non-controversial session? Something always pops up, right?
Yes, right. Yeah, well, I mean, I think there's great opportunity if people, advocates on education, are ready to seize them, to seize the opportunities that are not necessarily the expected. I think there's room for surprises, there's room for creative solutions, and I think that there would be a willingness by Republicans and by the governor to support those kinds of initiatives.
How do you see this issue play?
This is going to get caught up in a lot of politics, because what's going to happen is, even though the governor and the speaker and the Senate president pro tempore all made it clear, look, guys, it's not a budget year, that it's not going to stop folks from getting up on the floor and offering up amendments saying, hey, we're going to take this much from the surplus for teacher pay, or use this for teacher pay, or close these tax cuts. Are they serious? No, they all just want, you know, photographs and put people on the record to vote, because this is a political year and the whole House is up and half the Senate is up. And so we're going to see a lot of political gamesmanship on this teacher pay issue.
What else do you see, Mike, as the session gets underway? What else are you keeping an eye on?
Well, there's always, every year there's gambling, whether it's in the front of the chamber or in the back of the chamber, there's always talk about gambling. Gambling dominates every session to some degree, whether it's the money or wanting less taxes, less regulation.
There's been a lot of expansion already, just in the last year.
Yeah, but there's, you know, Terre Haute, we still have to get through Terre Haute. They passed a lot of last year to make it, you know, possible, but there could be some changes there. You have to remember there's 150 egos, okay, in between two chambers. I remember Mitch Daniels' first year, he wanted to do everything by executive order. And then he said, okay, we can do bills, but no amendments. But when you have 150 egos, there's going to be a lot of turmoil and a lot of ideas that we may not even know about here today.
What other issues do you see on the horizon? We also had Friday a bill introduced by State Senator Ford dealing with discrimination. Ron Colley's former guidance counselor was there. You've got that issue, which seems to continue to make headlines at the State House. What else do you see on the horizon this year?
On the education front, so I would hope that some of the things that have become part of the Red for Ed agenda do move forward. I think those are kind of low-hanging fruit. I think that the hold harmless on iLearn, I would rather see that kind of become, we seem to do this a lot.
And that's going to come up in committee Monday already.
Right. Yeah. And so it seems to be a reoccurring theme that we switch these assessments. So why not just take care of it once and for all in some way that perhaps you just, you know, have a statute that every time you change the assessment, there is some hold harmless clause or a reset of some sort. So that it's not, you know, so it's not argument every time you come around, because, you know, if the future looks like the past, we tend to like to change how we evaluate our kids.
Yeah, that issue, bill's already been drafted on that Senate bill, too, that comes up Monday. Anything else you're keeping an eye on, Abdul?
Keep a major eye on health care. That is going to be sort of the mother of all debates, and we're just starting, whether it is things like surprise billing, where things like, you know, whether hospitals have monopolies, you know, in certain areas, whether it is things like, you know, people going after IU Health, saying that, you know, they're supposed to be not-for-profit, but they had $1 billion, you know, in profits last year. The IU Health people say, well, we put that into our foundation to do to charitable work, but no, but healthcare is going to be a major issue when lawmakers, like I said, come back starting Monday.
All right, let's talk about the latest news now from Washington as well. As if things couldn't get more tense in the nation's capital, not only are we dealing with a looming impeachment trial, now also a potential conflict in the Middle East after the president ordered a military strike Thursday that's brought a lot of reaction, Mike, in the world of politics already.
You can't. Well, first of all, we here at this table don't have the information to really judge one way or the other whether the president was, you know, made a good decision. I hope that he's thought through what is going to happen next, what the next two or three steps are. But what I'm worried about, and I hope we're all worried about, is Hoosiers who are in harm's way. We talk about the 82nd Airborne. The 38th Division has been in Kuwait now for 6 months, and you never know where they're going to ship them. But, you know, my friend Danielle Chrysler, who worked for Mitch Daniels, she's there as the XO of the 38th Division. They are definitely in harm's way, and I hope they all come home safely.
And something else to think about, too, is I thought it was interesting how history kind of repeats itself. Back in the late 90s, when Bill Clinton was going through his impeachment, there was an issue with Iraq, and the president fired cruise missiles. Everybody was kind of saying, look, you know, this is Wag the Dog. He's just trying to, you know, distract us from, you know, his own problems at home. So I would not be surprised if you start hearing some of that pop up, you know, with the president, with his own impeachment situation looming.
And obviously with impeachment looming, such a divided time in the nation's capital right now.
Definitely waiting to understand more about this action, but you know, my confidence level is so low in his general abilities on foreign policy that I'm not encouraged.
All right, we'll see what happens next. All right, let's talk about the race for president. Former Mayor Pete Buttigieg, among those who've been critical of the president. Buttigieg finishing the fourth quarter with some impressive fundraising figures, but he's still in fourth in many of the national polls. He'll be spending a lot of time in Iowa, hoping for an impressive finish there. We also saw Julian Castro get out of the race this week. And we even saw Buttigieg go after Joe Biden a bit, saying he wouldn't want to have his son serving on the board of a foreign company. Here's how the Daily Beast wrote it up, saying the Cold War between Biden and Buttigieg suddenly burns hot. With less than a month now, Abdul, until the Iowa caucus.
Like I said, now is the part where the rubber, you know, hits the road. Probably this last set of, you know, Democrats standing is probably who we're going to see going forward into Iowa. Then you will see the next people drop off after Iowa. But I still don't think this will be decided for a while, because I can see a situation where one person wins Iowa, one person wins New Hampshire, another one wins South Carolina, and another one wins Nevada, and there's still no front runner here. And the person cheering the most on this is Donald Trump, because these guys are all spending their time and energy and resources fighting each other while he sort of, you know, skates his own renomination.
Well, we mentioned the former mayor's fundraising figures. President Trump certainly raising even more money than that. Is there a possibility of a contested convention, do you think? This process could play out? And how much staying power do you think former Mayor Buttigieg has in this race?
I think he's got staying power. I'm Team Pete all the way, so we'll see how far all the way is. But I don't think that at this point you can really make those predictions very well. I think that there's so much that can happen, what's just happening right now in Washington. I mean, there's a lot of very important ground to cover between now and when those decisions are made.
But the problem with Team Pete is he's missing two of the major demographics you need to win the presidency. African Americans don't like Pete Buttigieg. Millennials don't like Pete Buttigieg. Those are two big demographics. In fact, the entire Democratic Party has become the only white people need apply, quite frankly.
Well, there's an interesting article about millennials this week, too.
That's right, and political. Yeah. But they've knocked out Booker, pretty much. They've knocked out Harris. They've knocked out Castro. Yang can't get on the debate stage. And so you end up with a bunch of old white people are going to run against, one of the old white people is probably going to run against another old white guy in the Republican Party.
But even then, though, Bob, in defense of that, you know, just because you're black does not excuse you for being a bad candidate. Cory Booker, Kamala Harris, and Elon Castro were all really bad candidates. And I've never been a big believer in affirmative action, particularly when it comes to picking a president.
Well, a lot of times, obviously, in presidential politics, it comes down to raising money. So we'll see where it all goes from here, certainly. Up next this Sunday in Focus, guns in church and some new laws in the new year. We're talking about legal marijuana in a neighboring state and table games at Indiana casinos next.